ओम सदाशिव समारंभां शंकराचार्य मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्तां वंदे गुरु परंपरां। ओम सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ओम शांति शांति शांति। ओम नमो नारायणाय अध्यसंभूतः पृथिव्यैरसाच्च विश्वकर्मणः समवर्तताधि तस्य त्वष्टा विदधत्रूपमेति तत्पुरुषस्य विश्वमाजानमग्रे वेदाहमेतं पुरुषं महान्तम् आदित्यवर्णं तमसः परस्तात् तमेवं विद्वान् अमृत इह भवति नान्यः पन्था विद्यते यनाय प्रजापतिश्चरति गर्भे अन्तः अजायमानो बहुधा विजायते तस्य धीराः परिजानन्ति योनिम् मरीचीनां पदमिच्छन्ति वेधसः यो देवेभ्य आतपति यो देवानां पुरोहितः पूर्वो यो देवेभ्यो जातः नमो रुचाय ब्राह्मये रुचं ब्राह्मं जनयन्तः देवा अग्रे तदब्रुवन् यस्त्वैवं ब्राह्मणो विद्यात् तस्य देवा असन्वशे ह्रीश्च ते लक्ष्मीश्च पत्न्यौ अहोरात्रे पार्श्वे नक्षत्राणि रूपं अश्विनौ व्यात्तम् इष्टं मनिषाण अमुम मनिषाण सर्वम मनिषाण। ओम तच्छयोरावृणीमहे गातुं यज्ञाय गातुं यज्ञपतये दैवी स्वस्तिरस्तु नः स्वस्तिर्मानुषेभ्यः ऊर्ध्वं जिगातु भेषजं शन्नो अस्तु द्विपदे शञ्चतुष्पदे। ओम शांति शांति शांतिः। So we were looking at the Uttara Narayana, which is actually chanted after the Purusha Sukta itself. So the Purusha Sukta is having only 16 rigs in the Rig Veda, and it has two more rigs in the Yajur Veda. So we have seen that already, and we were looking at the Uttara Narayana. Even in the Uttara Narayana, I think we have covered the first four. Anyway, we'll quickly see. So even in the Uttara Narayanam, again, the Aditya Devata is praised here mainly, but Aditya also is not separate from Parabrahman, the Parama Purusha, who is talked about in the Purusha Sukta. So here, because this Tvashta is the name of Aditya, correct? So this Param Brahma only took the rupam or the form of this Aditya, and this entire creation was born out of all these pancha bhutas that is said here, although only prithivi and up, that is water and earth, are only mentioned, but they are only upalakshana for all the pancha bhutas. This entire brahmanda, this universe is born, and then this Parama Purusha only is there as the Virat Purusha, the one who is having the identity with this entire physical universe as his own body. Okay. And also the Parama Purusha only attained the form of Aditya also, and he shines. And this Parama Purusha, I know, the one who is doing the upasana, or here we have to say one who has the jnanam. The upasana part went before. So the one who knows that this Purusha is not separate from oneself. And what is one's own nature? It is Chaitanya Swarupam. I am this limitless conscious being, who is always shining. There is no ignorance. There is no darkness. Why? Because I know that I know. I know I do not know also, correct? So that is the consciousness we are talking about. It is neither knowledgeable nor ignorant. It keeps lighting up everything. This consciousness is the one to which everything becomes evident. Whether you know or you do not know, both are becoming evident to this consciousness. This is the consciousness to which it is becoming evident whether the eyes are seeing or not seeing, the ears are hearing or not hearing. Correct? This is said in Keno Upanishad also beautifully, correct? That's why Atma itself is talked about as Shrotrasya Shrotram, Manasaha Manaha, like that. Ear of the ear, mind of the mind and all that. Or even the seer of sight, like that it is talked about. Because whether sight is happening or not, it is known to whom? That is this Chaitanyam. It is like saying the sun is free from all impurities, correct? It is always shining bright. It doesn't have any darkness. Even though the cloud may cover the sun, the very fact that the cloud is covering the sun, you know, because of sun's light. Is that clear? So ignorance also is like that. Ignorance is a covering. But even the knowledge of that ignorance is there because of the Chaitanya Swarupam which you are. Because of your consciousness only, even ignorance becomes evident. So that conscious being is beyond all ignorance, darkness. And if you know that you are that limitless, then you are free, because you have no birth, no death. You are always there. In fact, everything is born and everything is gone in you. Even space-time is in you. You are not in space-time. Understand that. Space-time is there in this consciousness. And for this moksha, okay, Ayana is also talked about mukti, even in Nighantu and all that. So for this, there is no other way. Only through jnanam you can get it. This multipath confusion is there. You know, last 100 years, I think it has become even more pronounced that there are four paths. Karma yoga for, I don't know, for what kind of people. Those who want to do physical work, maybe. Then Raja yoga for those who want to do meditation. Then Bhakti yoga for those who are very emotionally attached to the Lord. Then Jnana yoga for the intellectual people. And all four of them will lead you to moksha. This is not correct understanding. This four-path confusion is there, unfortunately. Even in the Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavan only talks about two nishtas. Lokesmin vividha nishta. But nishta there is a lifestyle. A lifestyle to prepare yourself for receiving jnanam. Jnanam alone can give you moksha. Understand that. And Bhagavan says, I have four types of bhaktas. But jnani is myself only. Jnani to atmaiva memata. So, and he praises the jnani so much. So jnani is different, bhakta is different and all is not correct understanding again. A jnani is the one who sees everything as Bhagavan. In fact, he is the best bhakta because the jnani has surrendered the limitations. You surrender all your limitations and you find that you are limitless in fact, correct? That's all you have to do. You discover your limitlessness. How? By surrendering the limitations which anyway do not belong to you originally. All the limitations are not the limitations of the conscious being. All the limitations are all of the objects of cognition. You are wrongly identifying yourself, the subject, with objects of consciousness, objects of knowledge, objects of cognition. Whatever I see can never be I. This is a very fundamental thing. But you see your body, you take your body as I. You use your indriyas, sense organs, eyes, nose, ears, but you have a identity on them, self-identity. You claim that I am blind, I am deaf, all these things based on your sense organs. So the qualities of your sense organs you superimpose on yourself and then suffer. Qualities of mind also you take it on yourself. Whatever is happening in the mind is evident to whom? That Chaitanyam you are, that consciousness you are. That's what you have to appreciate. So everywhere there is error. There is a... These are all locus of errors, in fact. You are placing wrongly your identity on objects when you can never be the object. You are always the eternal subject who is of the nature of consciousness. So this is what you have to know. For this knowledge, everything is preparatory. What kind of lifestyle you lead, whether you lead a lifestyle of karma yoga as a grihastha, or you give up everything and take up vividisha sannyasa. You take up sannyasa, you simplify your life and want to only pursue knowledge without doing anything else. That is the two lifestyle Bhagavan is talking about. Jnana yogena sankhyanam, karma yogena yoginam. So when Bhagavan, even in Gita, talks about jnana yoga, karma yoga. In fact, jnana yoga is for someone who has already matured enough, who has the vairagya. For those who are not having the dispassion, karma yoga alone they have to go through. Correct? They have to develop the attitude of yoga and do karma and get certain maturity so that they are not under the spell of their likes and dislikes. If you take to sannyasa with all likes and dislikes intact, then in fact it will become dukkha. Sanya, he says that dukkham aptum ayogataha. Sanyasastu mahabaho dukkham aptum ayogataha. So that's why two lifestyles are there. Even throughout Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavan did not think Arjuna is fit for becoming a sannyasi. In fact, Arjuna wants to become a sannyasi because he thought by becoming a sannyasi he can run away from the battle. Correct. But Bhagavan keeps saying what? You do whatever is your duty right now. Running away from the battlefield is not the duty of a kshatriya. First you do your duty here. So, this karma yoga is a preparatory step. It is to prepare yourself to gain this jnanam. Or you have a certain maturity already and you decided that I want to simplify my life and only pursue moksha, this knowledge. Then you have another lifestyle. Jnana yogi means sankhyana, means there they are all sannyasis. Because a sannyasi gives up all other roles. Sannyasi has only two roles, either a student or a teacher. You can be a guru or a sishya. Sannyasi is not even a citizen. That's why in those days sannyasis can go anywhere. In fact, nowadays sannyasis take passport, visa and all that. Even that is against the spirit of sannyasa because you have given up the role of a citizen also, really speaking. You are no more a son, daughter, husband, wife, whatever, all the roles, employer, employee, every other role you give up. And you even proclaim when you take sannyasa that I do not compete with anybody in all three worlds. I am no more a competitor in the society. Bhuhu sannyastam maya, boha sannyastam maya, like that. Sannyasi has to give up and not compete. That is the lifestyle. So it's only a lifestyle. Whether you live in the society and do karma with the attitude of yoga, and you can still be a king like Janaka and a jnani also. By being in that, being a karma yogi also, you have to anyway pursue knowledge. Shravana manana nididhyasanam you have to do, and you can gain knowledge being a grihastha also. Or you take up exclusively only the pursuit of knowledge, there also you are gaining knowledge. So whether you are a karma yogi or a jnana yogi, everybody is only pursuing knowledge, because jnanat eva kaivalyam, this moksha or ayanam, there is no other way for that. You have to know aham veda etam purusham mahantam, you have to know this great limitless purusha who is not separate from, who is you in fact, correct, who is not separate from you. Then what about this bhakti yoga, raja yoga and all that means? There is no karma yoga or jnana yoga without bhakti. First you have to understand Ishvara, this purusha. Ishvara only has become everything. Nothing is separate from Ishvara. Everything is in order. Unless you appreciate that as an individual, how are you going to appreciate that Ishvara only is you? So without bhakti, mumukshu also is a bhakta, Bhagavan says. Because jignyasu, he says, artho jignyasur artharthi jnani cha bharatarshava chaturvido bhajante maam. So jignyasu bhakta is the greatest bhakta. Why? You just have some emotional bhakti towards Krishna as a whatever. Krishna, you can look upon as your child, Balakrishna, or as your lover. You yourself, you become Radha and Krishna is your lover. Like that and all, people are there. But more than all that, jignyasu means what? You want to know the swarupa of Krishna. Who is Krishna? What is the nature of Krishna? If you understand that, then you become jnani. So jignyasu is one who just does not want to keep Bhagavan also as one of the objects of knowledge. In fact, by making Bhagavan as one of the objects of knowledge, you are limiting Bhagavan, correct? Bhagavan is both object and subject. That's what we have to understand. Whatever is there here, the Purusha Sukta is about that only, correct? Whatever is there here, everything is not separate from Bhagavan. The Bhagavan alone has entered you also. That also comes here, correct? Prajapati Charati Garbhe Antaha. Prajapati only has entered into this creation and is there as the subject also. Not only is here it is talking about the objective world, you can say. But even here the subject also is talked about, because Samavartatadhi means what? The one who has the identity as the subject. One who identifies with the body is the subject, correct? So both subject and object are Bhagavan. Bhagavan only is Antaryami, who is sitting there within you. And the beauty of all this is what? Ajayamano bahudha vijayate. The one who is never born, correct? But who appears as many, mayaya. Like even the gold appears as n number of jewelry. Gold without losing its nature becomes jewelry. Even while it is jewelry, it is gold. Even if it is not jewelry, it is gold. Even after jewelry is destroyed, it is gold. Gold is always gold. In fact, it was never born as jewelry. Jewelry is only name and form. It doesn't have any existence of its own. Ajaya mano bahudha vijayate. So this you have to understand. To understand this, there are some prerequisites. First, you have to be free from your likes and dislikes. Why? Because likes and dislikes imply that you are a limited person. Understand that. If you have a want, means what does it imply? It implies that you are lacking something. You are a limited being. Only a limited being wants to acquire something else and become or feel at least limitless, correct? Or at least that lack you are trying to get rid of. But you can never get rid of all your limitations just by acquiring finite things. How many ever finite things you acquire, it will never become infinite. By getting hold of limited things, you cannot become limitless. In fact, your problem is not acquiring anything, or it's not going to be solved by acquiring anything. Your problem is the limitation which is centered on yourself. You are the problem. Understand that. And the solution also has to be you only. You have to find the solution in you, because you are the problem. In your own vision, you are limited. That is your problem. So the problem is centered on you. Then the solution also has to be centered on you. You cannot go and find it outside, correct? It is like my guru used to tell a story, interestingly. So one day he was walking down the village road, it seems. And one person was searching for something under the street light. In those days, street lights were there, but there was no electricity in the hut and all that, in small hutments. So one person in front of his hut, he is searching something in the street light. He asked him, "Hey, what are you searching? Can I help you?" And that person says, "Yeah, I lost my needle. I wanted to sew something and I'm searching it here." Then he was asked a question, "Where did you put that needle? When did it get down? Or when did it get out of your hand and fall down? We'll go and look there." Then he says, "That happened within the hut." "Then why are you searching here under the light outside on the streets?" Means he says, "Here only light is there. there is no light, I cannot search." Like that, you put it somewhere else. Your problem is somewhere else. You are not going to find the solution by searching somewhere else. Understand that. You have to find the solution also wherever the problem is, correct? First identify the problem correctly. Otherwise, you are not going to get the solution at all, in fact. So, all the issues are in the way I identify myself. So my identity itself has to be transformed. There has to be a self-transformation born in the wake of whatever Veda is revealing about me. So Veda is a means of knowledge. It is like a mirror. It is showing me my real nature. I am taking myself wrongly. I have taken myself for granted all these years, thinking I am a limited being. Veda is saying, no, you are the limitless conscious being in whom this entire creation is there. You are the basis of this entire creation. But then you say, no, I'm not understanding that. I don't feel that. So you now require to prepare yourself to gain this knowledge. And everything is a preparation. The entire preparation is called yoga, in fact. Whether it is karma yoga, bhakti yoga, everything, jnana yoga also is in one way preparation only. You take up a lifestyle which prepares you to gain this knowledge finally. Even dhyanam also, because typically two things we say. First, you have to be free from your likes and dislikes. Then you should have a mind which can focus, single pointed, one pointed focus. So chitta shuddhi, chitta naishchalyam. We talk about these two. So traditionally, chitta shuddhi is supposed to come by doing all this Vaidika karma with yoga buddhi. Chitta naishchalyam, you do all the upasana. Even here we had this upasana, virat upasana. You can do upasana that the entire srishti is there in your body. Different angas of your body you can visualize this as different parts of this srishti. Because whatever is there in the Brahmanda is there in the Pinda. Anda and Pinda and all like that, there is a concept, correct? Whatever is there in the macrocosm is there in the microcosm also. So you can visualize and you do upasana like that. That is also going to help you to appreciate this jnanam finally, and it will also give you a certain ability to focus. Karma and upasana, done with the right attitude, is going to give you chitta shuddhi, chitta naischalyam. Nowadays you call it karma yoga and jnana, whatever, raja yoga, you do meditation also, let us say. But both karma yogi or you are a raja yogi, you have to appreciate Bhagavan. Without Bhagavan, there is no karma yoga, in fact. Because in karma yoga, you have to appreciate Bhagavan as the karma phala data. Bhagavan is the one who is giving everything to us. Whatever comes to us as karma phala, the results of action, is nothing but a prasada from Bhagavan. That is the attitude you are developing. So where is the question of the karma yogi not being a bhakti yogi? And even in meditation, Bhagavan only is there in you as the one, the antaryami. And you can visualize Bhagavan. We do japa. We can start with japa, correct? Dhyanam means saguna brahma vishaya manasa vyapara. That's how we define. So dhyanam also is your object of dhyanam, meditation is Bhagavan only. Without Bhagavan, there is no dhyanam. And dhyanam also has to lead you to appreciate that everything is Bhagavan. So this chitta shuddhi, chitta naischalyam, these are all prerequisites you have to gain to appreciate yourself as all that is here, the limitless conscious being. So only jnanam will give you moksha. There is no other path or anything. So this multiple path confusion has to go away. And those who know this, the Viveki Purushas, who know the Karana Swarupa of everything, Yonim here means Tasya Dhira Parijananti Yonim is there, correct? Yoni is what? Yoni means the source of everything. Whatever we see here, this jagat is a karya. The karana rupa and the swarupa of the karana we have to see. That you know means it is not separate from yourself, in fact, once you know that. And those who wish to become like all these great rishis who had this knowledge, correct? Marichi naam padamichanti vedasaha. So they have to make efforts to gain this knowledge. Those who want to become like all these great rishis and devas who have this knowledge. And then further what we saw, yo deve bhya atapati, the one who shines as the devas. Whatever devas have something special, correct? They have, let us say, divine quality, divine effulgence. But who is shining in the devas? Their devatvam is from whom? Means this Paramapurusha, this Chaitanyam alone is shining there. And devanam purohitaha, the one who guides the devas also. And one who was born before all these devas. And to that param brahmaye. Okay, Brahman means Brahmanaha Yogyam, like that Shayanacharya is saying. So the one who is with this Brahman, like that we can take meaning, or one who is the all the Shakti of the Brahman. To that Ruchaya also, one who is shining. So here we can take this as Aditya Devata also, if we are saying this portion is praising Aditya Devata. Because we say Aditya is Pratyaksham Brahma, correct? Only in the presence of Aditya, all the activities are happening on earth. Like that, in the presence of consciousness, this whole universe is acting. All the activities are happening. So this Aditya Devata, my Namaskara, Namaha, the word Namaha also is interesting. Na Maha, like that they separate and give a meaning. Na Vidyate Maha Mama Kinchit. So Namaha, Namaha, when we say, what is the meaning? Na Vidyate Mama, that is the meaning. Na Vidyate Mama means what? There is nothing mine. Whatever I thought is I, and whatever I thought is mine, none of that is mine really, correct? I thought the body is I, or at least I think body is mine, if not I. But no, body is made up of Panchabhuta. You take the body, you have all these solid things, correct? Carbon, etc. All organic compounds are there. Then without, in fact, 70% of body is water. Then fire, temperature has to be there. Energy has to be there. Digestion has to happen. There are acid and all that in the stomach also. That is called Jataragni. So fire is there. That's what cooks and then nourishes. Then of course you have to breathe, correct? Vayu, if you are not breathing, then you are only dead body. There is no life. Prana. And then space also has to be there. So Panchabhuta, body is nothing but Panchabhutani. Even mind is nothing but Panchabhutani. We say that body is the tamas aspect. The prana is rajas aspect of Panchabhuta. Manas is sattva aspect of Panchabhuta. So in the Panchabhuta, we also bring in the trigunas. And that's how we understand. Now all this is nothing but Bhagavan. Ishvara is only manifest. Then how can you say this body is yourself? Or this body is mine? In fact, if you claim this body is mine, your mother will have also a claim, correct? Originally, your body is nothing but a part of your mother's body. Your mother only nourished you before you were born. Even after you were born, your mother only nourished you. Your mother has claim over this body. All the bacteria which are living in your gut, without gut bacteria, nobody can digest anything. And they are living there for generations. They will have claim over this body, correct? More than your claim. Because they are, even in India, you go and occupy somebody's land and nobody challenges you for 12 years, then it becomes yours. That is the law, unfortunately. So, like that, bacteria are there for generations in your gut, all over your body. They have more claim. So whatever you think is yours, it's not really mine. In fact, everything is Bhagavan. Whether it is this body or whatever else, this home you think is yours. So many things you think it is all yours. Each and every vibhuti also is Bhagavan only, he says. Wherever there is any glory, I am manifesting. You take the 10th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, it's all about glories of Bhagavan, Vibhuti Yoga. And wherever something special is there, Bhagavan says, that is me only. I am only manifesting. So even if you have some special talents, you have some fame because of that, it's all because of Bhagavan only. Understand that. Bhagavan is manifesting. His glory is manifesting in you. So na mama, na vidyate mama, that is the attitude. Whenever you do namaskara, what is the attitude? What is it that you have to contemplate and understand? Whenever you do namaskara anywhere, you are understanding that everything is given in fact. The day I was born, I am totally helpless. Everything is given. Otherwise, I wouldn't have even survived for one day. Understand that. When I was born, already air is there. Right amount of oxygen percentage is there in the air. Water is available. Milk is available from my mother. Later on, everything else, nourishing food is given. Everything is given. Given, 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 given. Then who is the giver? You have to appreciate the giver. Giver is this Paramapurusha. You appreciate the giver first. And then you develop a certain equanimity. Whatever is given to you, you are able to accept it, because you are not the author of any of these things. Don't take the responsibility on yourself. That's what Bhagavan says. You do your karma. Karmani eva adhikaraha te. Ma phaleshu kadachana. You are not the author of the results, because results are coming from Bhagavan. Bhagavan's altar. You have to take it only as a prasada. So the giver has to be appreciated. So you are saying na vidyate mama. That is the attitude of namaha. So when you do namaskara, you are appreciating that Bhagavan has given everything. Bhagavan is the giver. Whatever has come to you, it is all come like a prasada from the altar of Bhagavan. And when we receive prasada, we receive everything with the same reverence. The attitude towards prasada. Prasada itself is not one particular object, correct? What makes an object a prasada? It is your own attitude towards that. If you know that it has come from the altar of Bhagavan, you are ready to accept anything, whether it is a teertham or a laddu or whether it is some ash. You don't say, no, I don't want ash. Give me only laddu. I'll have only laddu. That's not the attitude towards prasada, correct? Once you understand what is prasada, you accept everything with reverence. But once you know that everything is given by Bhagavan, Bhagavan only is the giver, everything, all the results of your action, your body also is nothing but karma phala, correct? This life, whatever is happening to you, everything is karma phala. So that means your entire life, whatever is happening, everything is given by Bhagavan. It's all coming from the altar of Bhagavan. And you accept it as prasada, then you have equanimity. You accept it with the attitude that it is all prasada. So the prasada buddhi you have to extend. That is where this namaha, namaha will help you. So anyway, nothing is yours. Correct? Everything is given by Bhagavan. So accept it gracefully. Accepting gracefully means there is no more any sorrow. Understand that sorrow or sadness is there because of non-acceptance of the reality. Everybody has difficulties in life. Understand that. There are always pleasant moments. There are unpleasant moments. There are difficult times. There are happy times. All these things are there for everybody. But when do you have sorrow or sadness? Means you refuse to accept whatever has happened. You still think, why did this happen to me? Why should this happen to me alone? My neighbor is happy. All that also. So sorrow is a state you end up in by thinking in a certain manner. But if you are able to accept, in fact, if you are able to accept the reality, then you can even take some steps. Sorrow will make you immobilized. It will not let you do anything, in fact. That is the problem with being in sorrow, sadness. If you are accepting the reality, you can face the challenge then. You can think of doing something. So this attitude of accepting everything as something which has come as prasada from Bhagavan is a great blessing, in fact. That attitude comes when you do this namaha, namaha, namaha. You contemplate on that, you understand that, then that is going to help you. So the word namaha is a very special word. Namo ruchaya brahmaye rucham brahman janayantaha deva agre tadabhruvan yastvaivam brahmano vidyat tasya deva asanvashe. So this rucham brahman janayantaha, brahmam rucham janayantaha devaha agre tadabhruvan. So this again talks about the guru parampara we can take. Because the devas in the beginning, they talked about this brahman param brahma only. Tat chintanam, tat kathanam, anyonyam, tat prabodhanam, and all also we say. But see, there has to be always knowledge transmitted in a certain unbroken lineage. Whatever knowledge which we are teaching you today is not something I have invented. I learned it from my guru. My guru learned it from his guru. His guru learned it from his guru, like that it keeps on going. Who is the first guru means Bhagavan is the first guru. That's why even every Upanishad starts with, like Mundaka Upanishad says that Brahma taught this knowledge. And then later on it came through certain rishis. And then one particular person goes to a rishi and asks for this knowledge. Like that it is there always. Always a student goes, requests to be taught, and the teacher teaches. And that guru himself has learned from his guru. And his guru, his guru, his guru, finally Bhagavan. So even we chant Sadashiva Samarambham, Shankaracharya Madhyamam, correct? Sadashiva is the first guru. In between, Shankaracharya is an important link. Asmadacharya Paryantam, up to my guru, there is a parampara. So here, this parampara, Deva Agre Tadabhruvan, they talked about this Parambrahma to create Rucham, means Ruchi also you can say. To create interest, to propagate this knowledge. Rucham janayantaha, they were the ones, the devas who did this yajna and who gained this knowledge, correct? They did not just sit, they taught it further, they talked about it. So in our tradition, whoever gains knowledge should not keep it with themselves. In fact, there is a injunction that if you learn the Vedas and do not teach it, you will become a Brahmarakshasa. Knowledge has to be taught. That's how you preserve it, correct? It has to go to the next generation. So our guru used to always ask all his students to teach. And through teaching also you learn more. So you have to learn, you have to assimilate. You teach, you assimilate even more, it becomes clearer. And you also keep the lineage going. So that is very important. So yahatu evam brahmanaha vidyat. So the brahmana who knows like this, correct? So here some people even comment like Brahmana Jati and all that. Okay. Two ways you can look at it. The Brahmanas, even Jati Brahmanas who are doing all their karma and upasana, because Brahmanas can gain the Brahma, this Devaloka and all only by japa. They don't even have to do karma. Others are supposed to do karma. But Brahmana can do japa, mantra japa. That mantra dhinam, this entire world is daiva dhinam. Like that there is a sloka also. All the devas only are taking care of this world, correct? The entire world depends on the devas, but devas themselves are under this, you can say under this mantras, and mantras are there with the brahmanas. Therefore, I am, Bhagavan says, I am then under the spell of these brahmanas. Anyway, so Brahmana Jati you can take, but better is the one who knows Brahman is Brahmanaha. The one who has this knowledge of Paramapurusha as nothing but oneself. To that Jnani, all the Devas are in his Vasha, under his mastery. Why? Because he is, this Jnani is not separate from the self of the Devas. In fact, the Jnani has become the self of everybody. All the Devas. Jnani is now the Antaryami. Correct? So even all the Devas are under your Vasha, your mastery. You are overlording all of them. Like even Vamadeva said in the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, it says, Aham, I was Manu, I was Surya and all that. Vamadeva is in the womb. In the womb only he became Jnani. And then he proclaims, Aham Manur Abhavam, like that. So that is Jnani. Jnani is the, has the Sarvatma Bhava. Jnani is not separate from anything. That is Jnanam. You are the self of all. Sarva Bhutastam Atmanam Sarva Bhutani Cha Atmani. This is also said. This is said in Ishavasyam itself, Bhagavad Gita also. So, in each and every being, you are the self. And in yourself, each and every being is there also, that way also, both, correct? You are the self in each and every being. And all the beings are in yourself only. Sarva Bhutastam Atmanam, you are the self in all the Bhutas, living beings, all the beings. Sarva Bhutani Cha Atmani, Ikshate Yoga Yukta Atma, Sarvatra Samadarshanaha, like that, Bhagavad Gita. And then Ishavasyam, Yastu Sarva Ani Bhutani, like that there is a Ishavasya mantra also is there. So the Sarvatma Bhava, Jnani has Sarvatma Bhava, Jnani is the self of even Devas. So they are all under Jnani's Vasha. So the Jnani is praised here. The Guru Parampara is praised. Guru Parampara also is talked about, correct? How the Devas themselves initially talked about this Parambrahma and started this teaching tradition. So the tradition of teaching is very important for us. Vedanta cannot be preached on the roads, really speaking. Although some people go and distribute Bhagavad Gita and all on traffic signals. They are also doing good work, I think. At least they are distributing Bhagavad Gita. I am happy about that. So, but really, to gain knowledge, knowledge cannot be preached. Beliefs can be preached. Knowledge can only be taught. For that, you have to ask, in fact. It can only be given. You go to a university, enroll yourself, go to the class and sit. Then only the professor will teach. The professor cannot come to the road and preach quantum physics. If you are interested in quantum physics or mathematics or whatever it is, you have to enroll yourself in a course. Nowadays you can attend online course also. You don't even have to go to the university, but you have to show interest. You have to ask for it. Then it will be given. That's why this is a teaching tradition. This teaching tradition is a very important tradition. Trishchate lakshmischa patnyau ahoratre parshve nakshatrani rupam ashvino vyattam ishtam manishana amum manishana sarvam manishana. So again, this Parama Purusha only is talked about as everything. Krihi and Lakshmihi are patnis. So all our Bhagavan Parama Purusha also is happily married. Mother and father are together for us. It's all Shakti, correct? And here Hrihi means the one who has Lajja Abhimani, like that the commentators are saying, the one who has this Abhimana or identity with Lajja. That's a beautiful emotion, I think. The one who is shy, shyness. And Lakshmi is the one, Aishwarya Abhimani, one who is overlording. So, feminine aspect also is talked about here. Feminine is both shy and also the boss. Okay. So, Hirishcha, Te Lakshmischa Patnyau, Hrihi. And in another reading, I think in Shukla Yajurveda, Shrischa also is there. Shri and Lakshmi. Sri and Lakshmi is what we chant. So, and Ahoratre, this Aha, day and night also can be taken as besides this Parama Purusha, it is there, it seems. Or they, again, this Hiri is day, or Hiri is night, Lakshmi is day, like that also you can take. Two Patnis are day and night. They are Hiri and Lakshmi. But anyway, day and night are the sides of this Parama Purusha. Nakshatrani Rupam. All the stars are his form, in him only. And Ashvino Vyattam. Vyattam means Mukham. His mouth is all the Ashvini Devatas. So like this, you visualize this Aditya Devata, who is not separate from Parama Purusha. And then what do you ask? Ishtam Manishana, Amum Manishana, Sarvam Manishana, Ishana, Ichan. So you desire, means you ask for whatever you desire. So Ishtam means what? You do karma, Ishti. The karma phala is called Ishtam. So you are the one who is giving us all the karma phala. We desire for the karma phala, whatever karma we have done. That karma phala, let us come to us. Let us and give us all that we desire here, amum. But not only here, hereafter also, correct? Finally, what? Sarvam manishana. Sarvam here is what? Everything. Either you can say that give us all the things which are there desirable in all the lokas, sarva loka. But more relevant is what sarvam manishana means. Finally, what initially you are asking for karma phala and all that. But once you have recognized that karma phala is not a solution for your fundamental problem, then what are you asking for? You are asking for moksha, freedom from all limitations. That is Sarvatma Bhava. So that is what desiring that, you ask for that. Sarvam Manishana. So with this, this Uttara Narayana also is complete. So here the main Devata is Aditya, like I said, but again, lot of Vedanta is there here. And normally they chant this Shanti Mantra. Tachayo Ravrini Mahe Gatum Yajnaya गातुं यज्ञपतये दैवी स्वस्तिरस्तु नः स्वस्तिर्मानुषेभ्यः ऊर्ध्वं जिगातु भेषजं शन्नो अस्तु द्विपदे शञ्चतुष्पदे। तो तत् शम योहो आवृणी महे, वी आर अगेन दिस शांति मंत्र आल्सो इज आस्किंग प्रेयर ओनली, करेक्ट? इन प्रेयर नॉर्मली वी आस्क फॉर समथिंग, वी सीक फॉर समथिंग। सो शम मीन्स वॉट? Sham means mangalam, auspiciousness. So we are asking for that. And for what? Yajnaya, yajna pataye. Let all this yajnas flourish. May the one who is doing the yajna also, the master of the yajna, the lord of the yajna also flourish. And daivi swastihi astu naha. So swasti also is another word, correct? Swasti prajabhyav paripalayanta manal, we have prayer. So swasti means, again you can say auspiciousness, well-being, all this is called swasti. And daivihi swasti means what? This divine well-being, auspiciousness, let it there with be with us. Naha astu, let it be there for us. And let there be swastir manushebhyaha. Also, whatever is auspicious for all the human beings, let it be there. And all the plants, let them grow up. Urdham jigatu bheshajam. And let there be auspiciousness, shanno astu dvipade, for all the two-legged creatures. And auspiciousness for all four-legged creatures also. Shan chatushpate, dvipade chatushpade. 2 feet, all the animals and birds. 4 feet. Then what? So you... this Shanti mantra you say, and then always afterwards we say Om Shanti 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 Hi. 3 times Shanti we say because we want to resolve all the tapatrayam are there, correct? Which are centered on yourself, which are centered on your immediate surroundings, and which is centered on the devatas themselves, correct? This entire at a natural universe level, the forces of the universe. So all these 3 things mean they should not afflict me. Right? Tapatrayam we say. The afflictions which can come from yourself, which can come from your surroundings, which can come from the larger universe, from natural forces, all that let it be resolved. Let me be peaceful, happy. So that is the Shanti 3 times we say. So with this we have completed the Purusha Suktam and Uttara Narayana. We'll see what next we are going to see. I'll announce that. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.
धन्यवाद गुरुजी,
धन्यवाद।